Judges of the Court of Appeals, good morning. My name is Tom Gerarde, and I'm arguing this morning on behalf of the defendants. Your Honor, just picking up with the Peruta decision, which is the decision in our Connecticut appellate court. Our appellate court has held, yes, even though you have a permit to carry a weapon, you are not immune from disorderly conduct or breach of peace if you commit the elements of that crime. And I don't think
this... What did this man do that amounted to disorderly conduct?
All right, so we look at it from the police officer's perspective. The annoyance and alarm
when the police
inside
officer
the bar.
Arrived, correct me if I'm wrong, he's sitting on a bench outside.
Well, that's right. But the investigation revealed he spoke to the two people that were alarmed enough to dial 911 and say, we need you here, police, because there are people here who are alarmed by this man with a gun.
Yeah, but they didn't arrest him for disorderly conduct, right?
Well, he actually was arrested for disorderly conduct.
He was arrested, I thought, for breach of the peace, and then later on it was changed to disorderly conduct and then dismissed. Is that right?
He technically was never arrested for breach of peace. He was told at the scene, I'm arresting you for breach of peace, but when he was processed, disorderly was entered instead of breach of peace. So,
all right, so what did he
the
do?
Same element, though. It really would, they both apply.
All right, so what... What is the offensive or disorderly conduct that this man engaged in?
All right. Recklessly creating a risk of annoyance and alarm. He walks into a... It's almost like your ski mask scenario. He walks into a place, it's a bar, where they serve alcohol. He has his sidearm visible.
Which he has a right to do, right under Connecticut law.
He has a right to possess it. In his home is all that's really decided. But so, all right, so he has a permit. Well, he didn't get arrested for carrying a pistol without a permit. But he has a sidearm, and he has two magazines of backup ammunition. He literally has enough ammunition to kill everybody in the bar, if we want to be count numbers. Right? So he has people in the bar who are upset about it. When they see someone who doesn't have a uniform or a badge, we get upset. That's our contemporary society. We aren't Wyoming of 100 years ago, where probably no one would be upset.
But I thought the proprietor approached him and said, is it lawful for you to do this? And he said, it is. I'll leave if you want me to.
Well, that's not what's before our police who are making a judgment about whether or not there's arguable probable cause for a disorderly or a breach of peace, as it were. What's before our police is that they arrive and they see a very upset man named Mark Vanneman. He's our co-defendant, and he says that and the owner, Robert Hilton, they both say the crowd was agitated. They both say, and this is important, that he was asked to cover up and he said no. So if we want to dig into his mental state and whether or not he has recklessness in his mind, meaning knowing to a substantial certainty you'll cause the annoyance or alarm, it's not that he just has to guess that or predict that might happen, even though I think we all would predict that would happen. He was told, people are bothered by this. People are annoyed and alarmed by this.
But if he
wants you to carry it up.
If he had a right to carry the gun, then he had a right to carry the gun.
And
the fact that some people didn't like it doesn't make it illegal, because the Connecticut disorderly conduct statute has two components. One is a mens rea one, intent to cause annoyance or alarm. Let's assume he you know intended to raise eyebrows when he walked into the door of the Yale pool hall. But it also requires that he does so by offensive or disorderly conduct. And that's where I would like your guidance, because it doesn't seem to me that he did anything that constituted offensive or disorderly conduct.
All right, I'll just quickly...
And the police were told that the guy had a gun and that people there were patrons in the establishment that didn't like it. That doesn't seem to me to be disorderly conduct.
Well, just a quick comment. The mens rea can be recklessness as well as intent. Recklessly creating a risk of annoyance, and that's
right.
What we claim. So we'll get past that. The Peruta case makes it clear that we, or the Andersano case, we establish whether something's offensive or a legitimate annoyance enough to qualify for the crime by contemporary standards. And that's what I was getting at before. I mean, if this is 100 years ago in Wyoming where everyone has a gun, men and women, no one would be offended, annoyed, or alarmed by that. But this is not. This is Connecticut.
Even though it's illegal to, it's perfectly legal to carry a gun, I can be arrested because people in my immediate environments take umbrage to that.
Absolutely. If there's a valid disruption so that you have annoyance or alarm, it's the same thing as I have the right to speak any word I want, but if I scream fire in the crowded theater, I can be arrested for creating a disturbance, even though I have a First Amendment protection. He has a right to possess the gun.
That's the question. He didn't scream fire in a crowded theater. He didn't do anything.
Well, he did something by demonstrative conduct. He had a gun. He had ammunition. And it's almost like he has a right to wear a ski mask with a gun in the bank. When our gun possessors are trained in Connecticut, they get specific training. Use good judgment. You have a permit that allows you to carry this gun, but don't carry it out in the public because people are going to be alarmed.
They you just talk about at. The history in Connecticut, though. This has come up quite a few times, right? Whether the permit to carry, which is different from in your house, so it's the Section 28 part. The permit to carry, you can go to the mall, you can possess a handgun. Whether that carries with it the right to display the weapon as well. That's what we're talking about, open carry. In other words, no one's challenging the right to have someone who's has a gun permit to go to the mall as long as that handgun is concealed, as most people do. But what about the history in Connecticut of trying to address the issue of open carry? That has bounced around a lot, hasn't it?
It's bounced around and it doesn't have a landing point. That's the issue. But the police departments don't even actually know themselves if this is open carry or not open carry in our state. And they look for guidance, and I think what they're doing is erring on the side of caution that you will not be arrested for open carry just because you're openly carrying, but if you do cause alarm or annoyance, you will be arrested for breach of the peace. And that's affirmed by our appellate court, Your Honor.
There's no law that even says that, though, right? That a citizen is protected when he carries it openly. There's no decisions that even say that, right?
No, in fact, to say to the contrary, that the court, well, there's no decision that says you're protected from carrying a pistol without a permit arrest. There is none either way on that, but there's an affirmative statement from our appellate court that says you can be arrested for breach of peace or disorderly if you cause annoyance or alarm, and that will be judged by contemporary standards. And think about our contemporary standards. We don't carry guns. No one carries guns as citizens. I mean, they might have done it 100 years ago. Our contemporary experience is senseless acts of gun violence that scare the daylights out of us. We just had to read about what happened at UC Santa Barbara.
It's your position that you can violate the Connecticut statute, the disorderly conduct statute, that's 182, without engaging in offensive or disorderly conduct so long as those in your environs, take offense to what you do.
Well, I think you need to have both. I don't think those are two different things. I think it's if reasonable people are highly offended by what you do, that's the crimes committed, as long as you have the mens rea. I mean, he doesn't get to judge what's offensive and what isn't. He'd love to have a world where he could walk around with his gun and his magazine and everyone's fine with it, but that's not our world. That's not Connecticut. I was just going through the list.
So the law in Connecticut, as you understand it, is you can openly carry as long as the people around you don't have any problem with it.
Without conceding the open carry issue, I think that's the issue. I think you won't be arrested in Connecticut if you are carrying so long as no one else minds. But you have to know, and this is how they're trained.
It's not much of a right to carry, it seems to me.
Well, I think it's a responsibility. It's a social compact we have. I mean, we don't mind when law enforcement, if we see a badge and a uniform and a gun, no one minds. But when someone walks into a bar and he's got enough ammunition to cause who knows what horrible tragedy. I mean, we live with Newtown in our state. We read every single
thing. Do you think if the legislature in Connecticut amended those statutes and said, along with the gun permit, you can carry it openly, too, would that be protected by the Second Amendment? Does that matter that there's state regulation in it?
Well, I don't know. The Second Amendment is a completely blank slate right now. I don't know what the extent of the Second Amendment would be. And the last decision we had, in fact, the last decision by this court in the County of Westchester case was, What the scope of the Second Amendment protection is outside the home is a complete great unknown. I think great unknown was there. So that's why we rotate back to qualified immunity here.
But if Connecticut passed a statute that expressly permitted open carry, different from our situation here, that would affect the probable cause analysis for an offense like disorderly conduct, right?
I actually don't think it would, because the Peruta decision, and in the Peruta decision, the Connecticut Appellate Court said explicitly, you have your permit to carry, but that doesn't mean you can't be arrested.
You don't have immunity from disorderly conduct, so
right.
Even if you had a statutory entitlement to openly carry, if you then went out and made too much noise on a quiet street and were drunk and disorderly,
right.
I suppose
right.
You could be arrested. But if you had a statutory entitlement to openly carry, how could that be deemed offensive, even if people react to the fact of your openly carry?
It really is because it's not an unlimited right. And we have a social responsibility. We have this compact with the rest of the world that, yes, we have our rights, but we will also respect the rights of others in terms of disturbing them. It really brings up the fire scenario in the movie theater. We have a First Amendment right since way back when it was signed to say what we want. But if we say fire in a crowded theater,
your answer to this question, Mr. Gerarde, is: do you think that Connecticut law reasonably provides that a permit to carry carries with it the right to display it openly?
I come down on the side of no, because it's not crystal clear. It's not stated explicitly in something that should be stated explicitly. That's just where I come down now. I think we're going to see a lot more about that. But with this, I mean, there's many ways we can express ourselves. One is through spoken words. One is through conduct. And walking into a bank with a ski mask and a gun is expressive conduct.
Remind me specifically what the statute allows you to do, please.
I'm sorry, say it again?
Remind me explicitly of what the statute in Connecticut permits you to do.
The carrying a permit, the gun statute? Well,
yeah.
I can't quote it directly, but what it does say is that you will not possess a handgun without a permit to do so, and then it's silent as to whether or not that means you can openly carry it or have
but
to consume
it. There's two statutes. 35 says you even without a gun permit, you can have a handgun in your house.
In your home,
if you can
right.
figure out a way of getting it there, right?
Right.
You don't need a permit to carry. You can have it in your house.
In your house.
But the other statute, 28, says if you get from your local police chief and the state police a permit to carry, you then can lawfully carry that handgun around the state of Connecticut.
Right.
Right?
Yes, that's right. Yeah, that's exactly what it says. And it doesn't say openly. That's what the issue is, whether it's open or not. The Second Amendment, I think our district court had it right on the Second Amendment issue when he said, let's go right to qualified immunity because this is it's a complete blank slate. It's a great unknown, so you can't hang the officers on what they should have known or not back in 2010. Otherwise, I'll rely on the brief. Thank you.
Thank you.